Welcome to Design Domination, where you'll gain confidence, clarity, and a competitive edge in a crowded marketplace so you can dominate your competition. Hi, and thanks for tuning in. I'm Colleen Grotzer, and in this episode of Design Domination, I'm going to talk about how you can save time in Adobe InDesign with these 10 time-saving InDesign features that most designers don't know about or just don't use. And you know, the better that you know InDesign, the more efficient you will be. You'll know how to do things correctly and quickly right off the bat. So stay tuned to get these tips and you can thank me later. Also, the more you know InDesign, the easier it is to incorporate accessibility into your process. And that's because when it comes to creating accessible PDFs from InDesign, using proper practices in InDesign goes a long way toward that. So the first time-saving feature in InDesign is the Document Presets feature. And you can get to this by going to File, Document Presets, and then Define. Now, if you select the default setting and then Edit, this will be the default every time you create a new document. This can save you so much time, right? So if you want to set a default page size, for example, go for it. If you rarely use single pages and you usually create documents with facing pages, then just check off the option for facing pages. If most of your documents use a primary text frame, then check off that option. If you want to set a default number of columns, and a certain size for margins and gutter and bleed, go for it. And then every time that you create a new document, it will use these settings. I mean, if you save like 15 seconds on every single document create, think of how much time you'll save over your career. I mean, just saying. Now, the next one is the Adobe PDF Presets feature. And this is found under the File menu too. Now, this has so many uses. First off, when you're exporting to PDF, if you're constantly changing up the options, you can save so much time by creating presets to use on export based on your needs with every project. Second, you can save a preset from a client, such as if they have publications that need to meet certain specifications. And you can even load a preset from a printer or from another designer so that you don't have to manually set everything yourself. And then you simply export to Adobe PDF Print, and you will see all of your presets there. So, for example, I have a preset for client proofs, which is set to lower resolution. And then I have another one for print, where it sets the bleed amount, crop marks, and it also automatically downsamples images to 300 ppi and converts the document to CMYK. That not only saves time on export, but I don't have to go and change my images from RGB to CMYK. Because it just gets done automatically when I export to the PDF. And then I have other print presets that contain print settings for clients' commercial printers. Okay, another feature that you may not be using, which saves you tons of time, is the use of parent pages. But not just parent pages, nested parent pages, or child pages. Now, when you nest parent pages or create child pages, you're basing one or more of the parent pages off of another parent page. And to do that, you simply create a new parent page or use an existing one by right-clicking on that master page that you want to nest elsewhere, or you can click the flyout menu in the Pages palette and then clicking New Parent. And then you can give it its own name, and then you just want to make sure that you select based on parent and select the name of the one that you want to base it on. And then after you do that, if you want to, you can add additional content to that page. Okay, so, but why would you want to do this in the first place? Well, let's say that you have a long document with different sections. So you might have one layout for the pages at the start of each section that's, let's say, one column. Maybe they have a colored background and large margins. And maybe you want to use a different layout for text pages that are maybe two columns and smaller margins and no colored background. Having a separate parent page for each of these layouts is great, but when you nest all of your parent pages with different layouts on a single parent page that contains one or more common elements, then you don't have to change that in multiple places on multiple master pages, right? So the content that they have in common, you can change in one place. For example, you might want all or most of your pages to have a running footer with a page number. Instead of having the running footer be its own element on every single master page, you could have it on one master page and then base other masters off that, right? And that way, if you ever have to change the running footer or the running header, you know, whichever you have, then you can just change it in one place on one parent page. And this really comes in handy when you're working with complex publications. You don't have to go worry about changing something on multiple parent pages because you just do it in that one place and it's done. Okay, the next one is the smart text reflow. This is a huge help, especially when you're working on longer documents, but it's helpful nonetheless on shorter ones too. And this one's found in the InDesign preferences menu under type. You can set it to automatically add pages to the end of a story, a section, or a document. And you can also limit it to primary text frames and have it automatically delete empty pages. So what makes this feature so handy is that once you copy and paste text into the first page, it will automatically create additional pages based on the length of the copy. Another awesome feature that you may not be using is a text variable. Now here's a great use case for this. Okay, let's say you have a complex publication that has different sections and you want them to have a different running header or footer, right? You might decide to create separate parent pages for each of them. But guess what? You don't have to do that when you use a text variable. So you'll save time and you won't have to create so many parent pages. Okay, so just go to type and then text variables and then define. And then there are tons of options that you can use for text variables, such as the file name, creation date, modification date, metadata caption, and so forth. And the modification date could be especially helpful to input a date that a file was last modified. Okay, but then for the scenario I was just talking about with the running header or footer, you would choose running header and then select running header paragraph style. Then choose the paragraph style that you want to grab the content from. So in other words, if you have a paragraph style called H1, let's say, then choose that. And then you might also want to select first on page. And then you can also add in any characters that you might want to have before or after the title, such as a pipe, if you want it to be visually separate than from, say, the page number. And then you also have the options to delete any end punctuation or change the case. And then you just go to the parent page where you want to add the text variable and insert it by going to type, text variables, insert variable, and then choosing the one you want to insert. So you could have a text variable for the publication title and then another one for a section title. I mean, you can name them whatever you like, right? You know, you want to make it easy to remember what they are. And then you could also use a text variable in the content of the file too, not just on a parent page. Okay, number six is using styles. Now, I know designers hate using styles, but they save you so much time, especially when you set default styles and or when you have a long document, right? But they're also necessary in order to use text variables and to create a proper table of contents. You can create default paragraph styles, character styles, object styles, right? So like, let's say you want your images to always have text, a certain amount of text wrap, or maybe you want them to have a border. You could set that on the style so it automatically is like that. And then also table styles, including cell styles, and even designating their paragraph styles and assigning the cell styles in the table styles. You can also set your default color swatches. And all you have to do is just set them with no documents open so they become the default styles for any new documents that you create from that point on. I mean, these are huge time savers, even if you need to change the fonts and colors in every single document. Okay, now to save even more time, you can use the based on feature in your paragraph styles, in your default paragraph styles too, to base certain styles on others that have attributes in common. So for example, you might have a main heading. Let's say it's called a heading one, and maybe that style uses Source Sans Pro Bold. And then you might have a heading two, a subhead style that you want to be the same thing other than the size and maybe the color are different. Well, if you create that style to be based on the heading one style and then just tweak the font size and color, then what that means is that if you ever change the typeface for the heading one style, for example, or add a paragraph rule, it will also automatically change that in the heading two style as long as it hasn't been manually changed in that heading two style. Now, if you manually change something in the child style and you want it to go back to inheriting the attributes of the parent style again, you can just click reset to base and then redo any manual overrides that you want to have. So instead of changing maybe 10 paragraph styles individually to change the typeface or the color or something else they have in common, you can simply change one or a few paragraph styles that will then affect the paragraph styles that are based on them. This works too with any attribute that you might set, right? This could be the leading, the space after, indents, paragraph rules, etc. Okay, the paragraph shading feature is awesome, and I see a lot of designers not using this. But you can actually style text and give it a background without having to take the extra steps of adding a separate frame with the color and having to move it when text reflows. All you have to do is set this on the paragraph style. You can set the corner type, whether that be a right angle, rounded, beveled, and so forth, and you can also set the offset. Think of the offset as like the inner margins. And then you can set how the top and bottom edges align, like if the width should be to the column or to the text, and whether or not it should clip to the text frame so it won't exceed the text frame. Now, the advantage to this over a separate frame with the color is that when text reflows, the background, the shading, goes with it. Cool, right? Okay, some of the other options I set in my default paragraph styles and in all of my paragraph styles are the keep options. I have body text and bullets set to keep lines together. I do start to and end to. And that means I never have to go searching my documents for a stray single line of text anywhere. There's always going to be two lines kept together when that paragraph splits. I also set all headings to keep with the next three lines and to keep all lines together. So that means I never have a multi-line heading that splits across a page, a column, or text frames, and the heading will stay with the next three lines of text that appear after it. So, and my final InDesign tip is span and split columns. Now, a lot of times designers will create a separate single column text frame, like maybe for a headline, and or for a full width pull quote when the body text is laid out in two columns. Okay, and on the flip side of that, they might create a new text frame in multiple columns when the body text is in a single column. But did you know that you can use just one text frame to do all of that? You can use the span or split columns feature on a paragraph style. Now that means if you use a single two column text frame for the body copy, but you want your headline or pull quote to be full width across the columns, you can use the span columns feature to do that. You don't have to create a separate text frame and then try to calculate the proper spacing above and below the text frames before and after it. I mean, it's a huge time saver. Now, on the flip side, if you have a text frame with some copy in a single column, and you might want to have, for example, some short multi-column text of, let's say, some short snippets or bullet points, you could set that text to split columns and force it to be in multiple columns instead. And this is great because you don't have to create multiple text frames. If text reflows, you don't have to reposition the text frames all over again. Mind blown, right? Okay, so those are 10 of my top time-saving InDesign features that will save you tons of time, and I see so many designers not taking advantage of them. And some of these can keep you from having to check page by page for certain text reflow issues like I mentioned, but some will prevent you from having to create additional frames on the page, and some will keep you from having to add extra returns or breaks to get text where you want it to be. Let me know your favorite time-saving InDesign tip in a comment. Now, I also mentioned earlier that using InDesign properly goes a long way toward creating an accessible document, and it does. You can find out some common InDesign accessibility mistakes that most designers make by going to creative-boost.com/7mistakes and downloading the free guide.